You got both power!
You asked, we listened, and based on your feedback, we have a second round of PS4 Pro boost testing ready for you today. We're going to be looking at 9 games today, including Bloodborne, The Witcher 3, Until Dawn, and The Evil Within. But first, let's start with the one thing that everyone has been asking for. It's the PlayStation 4 web browser running in boost mode, and... Oh wait, nobody actually asked for this, did they? Okay, let's just do Bloodborne instead. The game everyone actually asked for. God's Chosen Spud, Oren, Antonio, Martin, Guillermo, Christian, Mr. Galdi, and so many others. This one's for you. Bloodborne is an amazing game, but its performance isn't especially great. This is due primarily to one significant issue, bad frame pacing. Bloodborne is the game which helped highlight how bothersome this problem can be, and even after the countless patches and cries from the community, the problem has never been addressed. Is it even possible to fix? Well, that's a good question, but as you've probably already noticed from the footage here, boost mode on the PS4 Pro does not solve this problem at all. As you run through the world, you'll notice that these same issues persist, and Bloodborne remains just as juddery as before. It really is a shame too, as the game itself is still a treat to play, and I think it looks rather nice for the most part. I believe most people were hoping to see this problem addressed here with the boost mode, so it's a little disappointing to find that nothing has really changed. Well, that's not entirely true either. Bloodborne also suffers from a host of minor frame rate dips at various points where we see it drop below the 30 frames per second line, and boost mode actually does manage to clear these problems right up. All of the minor dips I ran across during gameplay appear to have vanished. Now, it was never a huge problem in the first place, but it's nice to see some improvements here at least, even if the main frame pacing issues remain. Now, when capturing this footage, I opted to run through each scene rather than stay and fight in order to maximize the number of active enemies within any scene. Some of these foes will follow you throughout the level, and stacking them up into a large group can definitely cause additional drops in the game, which boost mode helps take care of. Of course, I wanted to spend some time looking at the chalice dungeons and try to find more strenuous locales, but it kind of highlights one of my biggest complaints with the game. You see, upon beating the final boss, you can start a new game plus, which drops you back to the start of the game with no possibility to go back to previously unlocked areas without playing through the entire game again. Still, based on the findings we've seen here, I think it's pretty clear that any drops below 30 frames per second are going to be cleaned up by using boost mode, so even those situations where things drop harder, you should be covered when using this mode. Now, another thing worth talking about here are the loading times. Since launch, load times have actually improved tremendously, but they're still nowhere near as quick as we might like. With boost mode engaged, we were kind of hoping we might see load times speed up a little bit, but unfortunately that isn't the case. Well, okay, so our test showed that it is 1 second faster, but that's really nothing special. Ultimately, boost mode does work pretty well with Bloodborne when it comes to eliminating standard drops below 30 frames per second, but loading remains largely the same, while frame pacing issues continue to rear their head throughout. In other words, it's better, but not tremendously so. But what about From's next game, Dark Souls 3? As Crimson Wing here and others have asked, are the problems evident in Bloodborne fixed in Dark Souls 3? Well, as you might expect, the answer here is no, not really. Dark Souls 3 was created using basically the same tools and technology as Bloodborne, and suffers from the exact same issues as well. Bad frame pacing is the big issue here, and it remains problematic. I will say that the issue doesn't feel quite as severe when using boost mode, but it certainly hasn't been eliminated. The only solution to bad frame pacing for Dark Souls 3 is to play it on the PC, which is exactly what I did in the first place. Now, just as we saw in Bloodborne, there are times when the frame rate drops below 30 frames per second, and these also seem to be taken care of here in Dark Souls 3. The game is smoother when played in this mode, and generally does feel a little more stable than Bloodborne overall. Loading times are of course very much in line with Bloodborne, and show no real improvement when using boost mode. Though thankfully, loading was never as much of a problem here in the first place. So So overall, Boost Mode offers a nice enhancement to overall performance, but the difference isn't transformative. Of course, it's also true that Dark Souls 3 is not the only Souls game on PlayStation 4, which is why we had to check out the game that preceded it as well, the complete version of Dark Souls 2, as requested by users such as Mr. Duff here. Okay, so Dark Souls 2 is a decent port of the original game, and on both Xbox One and PlayStation 4, the game aims for 60 frames per second. Unfortunately, once you start encountering loads of enemies or engage with the physics, the performance could often dip below this line. It wasn't uncommon to wind up with frame rates in the 50s, which is a little bit disappointing here. But the advantage of Boost Mode quickly becomes evident as the PS4 Pro no longer suffers from any troubles at all when handling this game. We ran through our typical test situation here, which seriously drops performance on all console versions of the game, but Boost Mode was able to power right through it without any real drops, just one single frame. It really plays very smoothly now. And this significant boost is enough to elevate Dark Souls 2 to the top of our list here. It sees massive gains across the board, and as slowdown typically appeared with lots of enemies or physics on screen, we can deduce that these improvements are probably due to the higher CPU clock speed. A nice improvement here. Okay, so over on NeoGAF then, Nachtfalke reminded me of another similar game that came out back in 2014 that I wanted to test. Lords of the Fallen. I originally played this game back at the time of release, and while it is quite a lovely looking title, the performance is rather unstable on consoles. Even in its current patch state, which is a huge improvement over the launch version by the way, the PS4 version exhibits slowdown and screen tearing that detracts from the experience. But once again, Boost Mode is here to save the day. Virtually all of these issues are eliminated, and the game now hums along at a mostly very stable 30 frames per second. Occasional drops can still pop up from time to time, but they are much less common than what we see on a standard PS4. The in-house engine designed for this game definitely benefits greatly from Boost Mode. Next up, we have a pair of horror games which have exhibited pretty serious performance issues in the past. The Evil Within and Until Dawn. Both of these games received a number of requests from various users, sometimes even right in succession. The Shonen 8899 is looking for some Until Dawn numbers, while George G himself is interested in The Evil Within. So let's get down to it. The Evil Within is an interesting one, and just to refresh your memory, it's based on id Tech 5, the engine which powered Rage and Wolfenstein The New Order. Tango Gameworks then, the game's developer, took it upon itself to implement a rich dynamic lighting system into the game while still making use of virtual texturing. The game does look pretty nice overall, but the performance is abysmal at points. Boost Mode does not seem to solve all of these issues, but it definitely puts up a good fight. Drops are less severe and tend to resolve more quickly all around. The game definitely feels much more responsive and smooth to play now with this feature enabled. And from what we understand, this is one title which places a huge demand on the CPU, specifically when dealing with the virtual textures. So it's likely that the increased clock speed on the CPU is playing a role in boosting the performance here. And also keep in mind that we're testing the full screen mode. Remember that the game originally shipped with only an ultra wide aspect ratio available, complete with black bars on the top and bottom. By enabling the full screen mode, performance was actually even worse. Also remember that this game launched in a pretty bad state. The version contained on the disc runs at a lower resolution with much slower performance than the fully patched version. Ultimately, Boost Mode does help a lot here, but it still won't deliver a stable 30 frames per second throughout, which is a little disappointing. So how about Until Dawn then? Well, this beloved horror title is based on Guerrilla Games' in-house technology recently christened the Decima Engine, the same engine Kojima Productions is using for Death Stranding. It is, of course, also used in Guerrilla's own Horizon Zero Dawn. Now, the other Dawn, Until Dawn, was developed by Supermassive Games and has gained quite a following, but unlike Guerrilla's own efforts, this is a game with pretty serious performance issues. And unfortunately, boost mode doesn't really make a huge difference here. We saw a similarly small boost with Killzone Shadowfall, but it's even smaller here. Much to our disappointment, the team opted for an uncapped frame rate as well, leading to performance that is all over the place. There is near constant judder, and boost mode just isn't enough to save the day here. The game continues to fall below the 30 frames per second line, but it also regularly jumps just above it. None of these situations are beneficial, and the game just never really feels very smooth. We'd love to see a 30 frames per second cap in place to improve consistency, but again, those dips below 30 FPS wouldn't be resolved. And it's a shame too, as this is a lovely game and it makes great use of the engine, at least in terms of the visuals on display. Fully volumetric lighting, highly detailed character models, and beautiful environments are the order of the day here. But like Bloodborne and Dark Souls 3, these improvements here with boost mode aren't really a game changer. If you're running this firmware and want to replay the game, well, it does make sense to leave it engaged, but don't go in expecting huge gains. Okay, so there's still three more games to talk about then, and I want to start with something a little odd. Alongside The Evil Within, Kyle here asked us to look at Oddworld New and Tasty and Hawken. How's 2 out of 3 sound, Kyle? That's right, we're looking at New and Tasty here, and for a good reason. Like Broforce, Oddworld is based on an older version of the Unity engine, and in its original form, suffers from some serious performance issues. Now, the Xbox One version actually offers a nice 30 frames per second cap, but on the PS4 you're limited to an uncapped frame rate that is highly variable. But as you can see, boost mode has a significant impact here. The frame rate leaps up by an average of 10 frames per second, leading to a smoother overall experience. Now, it's still not 60 frames per second, mind you, but it does feel a lot better overall. These earlier Unity games were often bottlenecked by the CPU then, so it should come as no surprise that there is an improvement here. Though after Broforce, I was a little concerned. It seems like the next Oddworld game, known as Soulstorm, is currently deep in production though, so if you haven't played this one, it might be time to give it a look. Next up then is another highly requested title, The Witcher 3. We heard from folks such as Silly Wabbit and Sean, but the main question is this.
My only question, does it make Geralt's beard look scruffier? Please tell me it does. That's the only thing it should do.
I'm sorry to disappoint you, Mr. Arnold, but boost mode does not improve Geralt's beard. But it does help performance, at least a tiny bit. You see, while The Witcher 3 launched with performance problems out of the gate, CD Projekt Red continued to patch the game, and in its final iteration, performance is very good on a regular PS4. In fact, it's almost a locked 30 frames per second now, which is nice to see. This ride through Novigrad used to be a stress test at one point, but as you can see, it no longer pushes the system to the breaking point, and even the regular PS4 powers through with little issue. But that doesn't mean that there aren't some enhancements here. This cutscene was always notorious for dropping the frame rate, and well, it still drops, just not to the same degree. You can definitely see a nice improvement in performance here using boost mode. It's not a huge jump, but it does result in a smoother overall cutscene. This certainly seems like a pure GPU related boost here, as the slowdown is tied to certain visual effects. Not a monumental difference, but it's still a nice improvement. And what about the old bog? This was another tricky spot for the PS4, with original numbers falling as low as 20 frames per second. even in its final form, there is still slowdown on a standard PS4, but Boost Mode is able to cope with it and completely smooths things out. It now runs at a stable 30 frames per second in this scene. And what about the loading times? Well, loading to Novigrad's center takes 95.1 seconds on a base system, while Boost Mode shortens that to 85 seconds, saving 10 seconds. Loading into Crookback Bog then takes 65 seconds in standard mode and 58.4 using Boost. Overall, that's a pretty significant improvement there, though loading times definitely remain rather lengthy. Still, if you never get around to finishing The Witcher 3 back when it was released, it might not be a bad time to revisit. All of the original complaints we leveled at the game have been eliminated in favor of a smooth, mostly stable 30 frames per second, especially with boost power. It really is a nice improvement here. Which brings us to our final game, Batman Arkham Knight. Rock on Mark over on Twitter pinpointed one of the game's biggest issues, so we just had to give it a look. The result? Those driving scenes absolutely do benefit here. On a regular PS4, we can see minor screen tearing and drops below 30 frames per second appear as we drive around the city. It's not a huge problem most of the time, but it does detract from the presentation. With Boost Mode enabled, however, these issues are cleaned right up and the game winds up running like a dream. A very solid 30 frames per second is easily achieved here, and it looks and plays better than before. We've seen other improvements with Unreal Engine 3 games, so it's no surprise to discover that Arkham Knight benefits as well. And really, this just reminds me of how beautiful the game actually is, and even on the base PS4, it runs pretty well overall. You just get that extra layer of polish when playing on a PS4 Pro with Boost Mode enabled. A great result all around. And that marks the end of Round 2, which covers many of the most commonly requested titles. Of these games, many of them enjoyed significant improvements to performance, resulting in a smoother overall experience all around, while others, like Bloodborne, saw little real gain in the end. We'll continue to keep an eye out on other games though, but that's all the time we have for the moment. If you found this video useful or interesting, be sure to give us a like, subscribe, and follow us on Twitter. And until next time, this is John signing off.